Hi, this is Lindsay Petras.
I'm Adam Sorma.
I'm Stephanie Bria.
Welcome to The Slaw.
Welcome to The Slaw.
The Slaw.
Very Local's podcast where we stay on top of all things Pittsburgh.
Each week, we highlight Pittsburgh places and Pittsburgh people.
We feature unique collaborations.
And even make some event recommendations.
The Slaw is all about the stories that make Pittsburgh, well, Pittsburgh. Pittsburgh.
From the makers.
To the mailman.
To the ladies in church basements churning out pierogies.
We're exploring our 90-some neighborhoods, revisiting well-known favorites,
and sharing fun new spots.
So, what is Very Local?
What is it?
We like to think we're a user's guide to the city of Pittsburgh.
Go on.
We'll tell you where to go,
what to know,
and what the parking will be like when you get there.
Food and beverage previews,
classes to take,
things to make,
people to meet.
It's all here.
It's all here.
Very Local is very
Pittsburgh. Hi, everyone. Welcome to The Slaw. I'm Stephanie Bria, and sitting with me today is Jessa Gibboney. Jessa is a writer and content creator. On her website, Wavy Alabaster, Jessa shares everything from the stories behind sustainable style to personal reflections on motherhood. Jessa works to elevate the slow fashion community in Pittsburgh, writing articles and spearheading events that tie into the larger international slow fashion community. I actually asked her when she got here, and she says her biggest style influences are nature, lifestyle, her daughter, Leandra Medine, founder of Man Repeller, and Stella McCartney. So you should all know that last name at the very least. According to her Instagram, we are both poets and poetry enthusiasts, which is actually one of the reasons I chose to interview her. But listeners, I promise we won't turn this into a poetry podcast. Full disclosure, she is also a very local freelancer. So, Jessa, welcome.
Thank you. Thank you for the intro.
Yeah. We're going to get right into it. What is slow fashion?
So, slow fashion, what I like to start off saying is stop shopping and start thinking. Think about where your clothes come from, how they're made, where they're produced, and how they get to you. Slow fashion, by another name, is sustainable style, sustainable fashion. There's a lot of different other words out there for it, but it's basically wearing what you have, being mindful of bringing in new objects into your closet, shopping secondhand, shopping vintage, and also repairing what you have just to kind of cut down on that life cycle of apparel. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. We want to get rid of disposable culture in that apparel industry. We don't want to wear a t-shirt one time and then throw it in the garbage. We don't want to put that in the landfill. So roundabout definition of slow fashion.
And so slow fashion, full disclosure again, I was like, slow fashion, what does that mean? But really, the principles behind it are things that a lot of people have been practicing for a very
absolutely
long time, right?
So, absolutely.
You know, in high school, and I was shopping at thrift stores already,
yes,
right?
Yes.
It was the 90s. I was wearing old man pants.
Yes.
You know, things like that. So really, it's just a different name on practices that people have been doing for a while.
Right. Like our zeitgeist has kind of culminated this into slow fashion. But like you said, we were talking earlier, your partner, he does it already. You mm-hmm. know what I mean? Like my husband does it as well. You're not shopping as much. You're being very careful about what you bring into your closet and how those items are made. And people have been doing it for years and years and years. Let's be honest. People have been making their own clothes. It was only until kind of our mass production happened in this fast fashion movement and just this new appeal, this having the latest trend, the latest style. And if you get that, you're going to become the person that you're supposed to be, right? Mm-hmm. That's what marketing does in the apparel yeah. fashion industry. But a lot of people do it. And it's just being mindful of what you're bringing into your closet.
And so what is the story sort of how the movement came to be named slow fashion? Do you know anything a little bit about the history where it's been happening for a long time, but this idea that it's now slow fashion? Do you know anything
about that? There is a specific article that coined the term, and I would have to look it up, but I believe the article was around 2007. Mm. And there was an author talking about sustainable fashion, and she coined that term slow fashion. And that's, again, it relates to a lot of different facets of the apparel industry. It relates to how clothes are made, the amount of clothes that you bring into your closet, and the production of it, right? The seasons. We've gone from 4 seasons to, 52 seasons. Like, it's just crazy the amount of clothing that is produced. And so slow fashion is just kind of stepping back and pausing, for sure, as far as what you're bringing into your closet, what you're bringing into your life. And, obviously, on the grand scale, too, what we're producing, mm-hmm. from a company perspective, from, you know, a small business perspective.
And why exactly slow fashion? So for you personally, what was sort of the impetus for your interest in slow fashion?
So I will be honest, I'm such a huge thrifting secondhand fan, but I really started out doing that for vanity reasons, right? I just liked the uniqueness of secondhand and thrifting. I loved the hunt.
Yep.
I loved having something that no one else had. And really, in the back of my mind, when I was in high school and college, thinking about the environment was not on my mind. It wasn't. And it wasn't until lately, and I really attribute Pittsburgh to this, with our just huge scene in vintage and slow fashion, and not even slow fashion, but secondhand thrifting. We have incredible local businesses and people that are really pushing forward in that arena. And that's when I started talking to local business owners. That's when I started researching a little bit more and figuring out, okay, this isn't only to find cool stuff. This is a really huge thing that we can be doing to helping our environment. And it's one way that we can do our small part.
And you, so you also have a young daughter. She's what, one now?
Yes. Oh, yeah,
look
you're
at me.
So
I did my
good.
Research.
Yeah. She just turned one on October 24th.
Okay. So did that have any sort of, did that play into it as well? Like how,
100%. If anything, I'm more gung-ho about it now. Again, Pittsburgh has amazing secondhand kids stores, like Kid to Kid Pittsburgh in the North Hills, Once Upon a Time in Monroeville. And there's awesome preschools. There's a preschool in Bellwood that does this spring and fall sale that is just incredible. And kids' clothes, they grow out of them so fast, they're barely used and they're in great condition. Like, why wouldn't you just use stuff that's already out there? I mean, really, I can say pretty confidently that 98% of my daughter's clothes is secondhand or thrifted.
And what percentage would you say yours are?
I would say, out of my stuff now, I would say I'm close to 80, around 80%. Mm-hmm. I definitely have some sustainably sourced. Like I have this wonderful two-piece jumpsuit from Luna, which is a boutique up in Swickley that I bought new. And I certainly do buy new things from time to time. And a lot of it is local now because there's a transparency there and I know how it's made, what it's made from, and I know the person that made it.
So you kind of touched on this a little bit. What does the slow fashion community look like in Pittsburgh? You said that Pittsburgh has a ton of vintage and used clothing stores filled with great stuff.
Awesome stuff.
I've moved around a lot. I will say that I do most of my like thrifting and antique. I mean, it's cheaper. There's so much stuff available.
So many. Oh,
but,
it's amazing.
What does the slow fashion community look like? How many people sort of do you actively sort of participate? How many people? Yeah.
Tons. There are tons because slow fashion is across the spectrum. There's a lot of different branches too. There's a lot of people that are going to go more toward that ethically sourced clothing and style and fashion. Like we have brands in the community that ethically source their resources or have circular materials.
And do you have examples of who those would be?
Yeah. So a great example is Not Slam Bow Tie Company. I always say if you're not sure what this slow fashion movement even means or how it's implemented from a company side, Nisha Blackwell does an incredible job of explaining how she repurposes textiles and turns them into these beautiful, unique bow ties. It's incredible. On her website, she has over 1,700 pounds of textile waste she has saved.
That's incredible.
And I mean, put a little asterisk there. I'm pretty sure that's what it was said on her website. But she has the actual impact that she's making. And she talks about bringing in people to teach them how to run a business. And I mean, everything that she does is really the epitome of what that slow fashion can look like in real life. Mm-hmm. Because it can be overwhelming.
And she employs a lot of local people.
Absolutely.
Right?
So absolutely. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yep. Born and raised in Pittsburgh. I mean, she's one of those leaders that you might not see on a global scale, but I mean, she'll get there because she's incredible.
Are there some other folks like that you would? So that's one branch of it. So that's sort of saving textiles.
Yep.
And then what are some other folks that you think are?
So like you said, vintage and secondhand scene. We have tons of people that are so great at just talking about what's happening in the slow fashion arena. So Kate from Highway Robbery, the person I did an event with in this past summer, She has been kind of charging Pittsburgh. She was one of the first vintage stores here over 8 years ago. And she's now bringing in reworked vintage, which is taking your typical things that you see in vintage stores. So like your flannel button downs, mm-hmm. your graphic tees, stuff that you're going to be able to find, especially that 90s nostalgia that's really coming back.
Yeah, I've noticed that. I was like, man, I should have kept everything I own.
Everything you own.
And then I could have sold it for a bunch of money right now. This stuff is like, I had that shirt and it's $80. Somebody's going to pay $80 for that?
Right, exactly. It's all cyclical, everybody. It's all cyclical.
Everybody, keep everything. No, don't keep everything. Keep everything.
If it doesn't have a hole in it. And if it does, patch it.
Yeah.
But she is a great person to talk to. She really opened my eyes to this reworked vintage. But anyone that really owns a thrifting store, a vintage store, clothing repair store, shoe repair, there is a new mending duo called Old Flame Mending, where they're all about sustainability and not letting go of those beloved pieces. I'm actually wearing overalls today that was from Highway Robbery, and I just wore them to death to the point of, like, I ripped a huge hole in them, sent it off to Old Flame, and they made it new mm-hmm. with, like, a cool patchwork design, and I love them. You know what I mean? I wasn't ready to give them up, nor were they. Their time wasn't up with me yet. So there are tons of different resources in Pittsburgh. Style 412 is a great place to go to. They interview different business-minded people, and they also have incorporated sustainable style. It's part of their mission. Also, Pittsburgh has just been really good at backing it. And they really want to show Pittsburgh on a grander scale and what they're doing. And sustainability is one of their pillars, especially in our emerging fashion industry.
Are you from Pittsburgh?
I am not from Pittsburgh. Okay. I'm originally from York, Pennsylvania. And then I moved to Pittsburgh 5 years ago from Philadelphia.
So I guess I was kind of, and you may or may not know the answer to this, but this idea of DIY or collaboration is stuff that we talk a lot about at Very Local. It's stuff that will be on this podcast a lot, which mm-hmm. Hopefully, you know, everyone will continue to listen and find out about all those things. But this idea, like, do you feel that Pittsburgh's inherent character traits of, like, you know, DIY or collaboration mm-hmm. or all of those things, do you think that kind of plays a role in why slow fashion is so sort of popular and it resonates so well here?
Absolutely. Another facet of slow fashion is clothing swapping, right? Like having a clothing swap where you bring a bag of clothes and you take clothes from other people. Mm-hmm. And that's, you know, you're taking clothes and giving life to an item that is being discarded by someone else. And that in itself, there's an element of trust and collaboration. It's just turning out as much as product mm-hmm. as possible. And they're relying on us to buy it. Mm-hmm. So really, we are enabling that fast fashion industry.
So we're going to switch gears a little bit here.
Yeah.
We're going to make some more recommendations. So this is a two-part question. One is, what is one vintage shop that more Pittsburghers should know about? And then the opposite, well, it's not really the opposite, but the opposite of that is, what about a thrift store? So, mm-hmm. I mean, I know the difference between a vintage shop and a thrift store.
Yeah.
Maybe we need to clarify that a little bit. So one vintage shop, and then conversely, like, I'll give away my trade secrets. Mine's the red, white, and blue and on 65.
Oh, yeah.
That's my favorite. That's
such a good one.
Actually, a lot of what I'm wearing is to come from there today.
Yeah. The one vintage store. Wow. I have so many favorites. Mm-hmm. There's so many favorites. I really enjoy Three Pigs Collective. They just opened a brick and mortar in Lawrenceville. They are artists. I mean, they have incredible pieces that they style to a point of it's living art. And so I think sometimes people might be intimidated to go into a shop like that, but they really do have some really quality pieces. They're just incredible. Ruling Woven is also in Lawrenceville, which I love so much. Kid to Kid, like from a thrifting mm-hmm. standpoint, I know I'm a new mother, but Kid to Kid in Pittsburgh in the North Hills, very close to Ross Park Mall, is amazing. Shout out to all the women that work there. It is really, really great. Obviously, I love my Highway Robbery.
So then what would be, if you were considering, like, thrift stores would be, you know, Goodwill, Red, White, and Blue.
Yep.
Are there some secret, if you want to give up a secret spot?
Or? No, yours was my secret.
Yeah.
Red, White, and Blue.
Yep.
Love Red, White, and Blue.
Yeah. It's good, guys. You should all go there. Everyone should go there.
It's really great. I just found two lamps there the other day that were amazing for my spare bedroom.
I really don't find housewares there, but almost all of, like, this sweater came from there. I mean, most of my clothes come from there. What are some ways to easily incorporate slow fashion choices into your wardrobe? So, for instance, we did an event that highlighted vintage Steelers gear at the beginning of Steelers season, right? So, you know, what about instead of going to the strip and buying the $10 t-shirt that are printed who knows where all the time, you know, what are some ways that you can incorporate sort of slow fashion choices, whether it's that or maybe it's even jewelry and accessories, because a lot of people don't spend a lot of money. I mean, people buy cheap stuff like that all the time too.
Yep.
What would you recommend if someone was like, I'm overwhelmed at this whole
It's overwhelming. Thing. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yep. It's like any problem. It can be very overwhelming. Where do I start?
Yeah.
I think it kind of reverts back to where we started, like just stop shopping, start thinking, you know, when you have this impulse to buy something new, just stop. You know, start with 1 week. Don't buy anything new. Then maybe go to 2 weeks. Maybe go to a month. It's like anything else. You need it to become habitual if it's going to stick. Also, just looking at some fabrics, materials, things like that. I mean, I could go into, you know, how polyester, acrylic, spandex, rayon, none of those are biodegradable. But an easier way is just to shop local. Like shopping local, you're going to have products that are made here in Pittsburgh, made in America. So that cuts down on shipping. It cuts down on the production line of that actual apparel. And obviously you're putting that money back into our local economy, which is great. But shopping local, and you're normally interacting with a person that's either making it or owning that shop. And so they're able to tell you where it's from. Granted, you don't need to go into every shop and ask them where it's from. But shopping local is a really great way if you want to buy something new, to kind of put yourself into that slow fashion mindset. Vintage, secondhand, all of that is so great. There's small ways that you can implement to work towards slow fashion. It's a big word, but it's a lot of small actions.
Great. All right. Well, I want to thank you so much. That's about all the time we have. I actually lied a little bit in your intro, and I am, sorry, everyone, I'm a liar. And I'm going to at least reference one line of poetry in this interview, because I thought that we would both appreciate it. So my coworker, Adam, we sit next to each other and our desks touch, and he actually went to your slow fashion event.
He did.
And you gave out a poem.
I did,
and it is taped above his desk, and I read it. I mean, I obviously see it all the time. And so there was one line especially that I'm going to read, but it says that the line is, "See this patch, it was once a hole. Mend apart, renew its whole." And I really love that. I think it also touches lightly on the idea of storytelling through clothing, which I think we both appreciate. Mm-hmm. I think that to me is a personally fulfilling reason to participate in slow fashion. I remember when this happened, when whatever this happened, and every time I rewear this piece, I have all those memories. You kind of touch on that with this idea of, like, I wasn't ready to give up these overalls yet.
Yes.
So yeah, I just wanted to highlight that one line of your poem. And I want to thank you so much for coming and talking about slow fashion.
Thank you.
To everyone listening, if you want to learn more about Jessa, you can follow her on Instagram at Jessa_Gibboney. We will put all of these links and other things that were mentioned in the show notes for this podcast.
So thanks so much for having me. This is so fun.
Great. Thanks. Collaborations. The very Pittsburgh collaboration that I'd like to highlight this week is Pittsburgh Record Night. So it's led by Ian Friend, who DJs around town as Soulful Fella, SOULFULFELLA. Pittsburgh Record Night essentially calls on folks to bring their own vinyl records and create their own party. So the collaboration really includes you and whoever else shows up. They currently have two locations, the first Saturday of the month at the Park House in the North Side, and then every Tuesday at Kelly's in East Liberty. For a while, they were at Newham, and I believe I just saw that they are occasionally elsewhere. So you pretty much just need to see where they pop up. You bring your records from home. You sign up on a regular old low-tech sheet of paper for your half-hour spot, and that's it. You're the DJ. You set the tone. You try to get people dancing. It's a mixture of amateurs and folks who are probably, I don't know if you would say professional DJs, but DJs with some experience. Anybody can attend. Anyone can participate. As an attendee, you never really know what you're going to get, because you never really know who's going to show up. And styles of music can vary. There's like Madonna, and there's old funk, and there's like electronic music. Everyone seems to have fun and come together in a collaborative spirit. I attend this occasionally, personally, and I really like when I see folks kind of try to create a really great transition between their set and the next person's set. I've seen, you know, old ladies on the dance floor at the Park House with their sons getting down. So it's really a good time. And I like the fact that really you create your own party. So the collaboration that we're highlighting this week is Pittsburgh Record Night. You can follow them at PGH Record Night on social media, figure out where they're at. If you have a bunch of records at home, figure out what would be a half hour set and you can show up and sign up and create your own party.
All right, guys, it's time for events. And this is Adam with Very Local. My event pick for the week is a rather simple event. I want to talk for a moment about Firefest. For folks who aren't familiar, Firefest is happening at Grist House Brewery in Millvale. It's going to be on December 7th. December 7th is a Saturday. That's going to be basically a celebration of fire. It is a very simple party. You just show up, wear your warm winter clothes, and Grist House will be providing several small fire pits, small sort of contained bonfires in their outdoor space. If you're unfamiliar with Grist House is a majority outside brewery. Per their description, they basically say, who says that you can't party in the cold? Here at Grist House, we don't like to be cooped up inside, so we make a point of utilizing our outdoor space all year round. The fire is always rolling for the beer lovers who brave the cold, and we want to celebrate that. So basically, this is the second iteration of Firefest. I went last year. It was awesome. Free to attend. You just show up and cozy up by one of the many fires happening. The one thing that is different this year is they're going to be adding an addition to the fire, which is going to be called the pit. And that'll be happening in the lower, sort of larger outdoor space on the left when you enter Grist House. They expanded their seating section. So look for that. They're going to be rolling out more details around beer releases and specifics around food and other amenities and things happening with that. So Firefest, December 7th at Grist House in Millvale. And that's it for events.
If you know of any upcoming events you think we should know about, or if there's a very Pittsburgh collaboration you think we should highlight, call us at 412-368-6595 and leave us a message. And thanks so much for listening.
Make sure you subscribe,
rate, and review The Slaw on iTunes
or wherever you listen to podcasts.
If you like what you're hearing, follow us at Very Local PGH on your preferred social media channel.